and be glad in it. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. He's worthy to be praised. 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 I just want to read this for our hearing on this morning. In Psalms 27. If you don't have your Bibles, I'm not speaking on this morning, but I wanted to share this nugget with you. This morning, Psalms 27, if you don't have your Bible, please God, I ask the ushers, raise your hands and they'll accompany you with the Bible. And if you don't own one, then the one that they give you, you can take with you. God is good, he's simply worthy to be praised. In Psalms 27, just want to share this. The Word of God says, very familiar passage. It says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation, and whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life, and whom shall I be afraid? And when the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, came up on me to eat of my flesh, they stumbled and fell." You can expect that. Praise God. Don't be intimidated by the enemy. Sometimes, praise God, I'm telling you, saints, praise God, sometimes, praise God, you got to ask the Lord to lift you up like wings of the eagle. Because sometimes when you're in the midst of it, it seems like it ain't no victory. But sometimes you got to ask the Lord just to raise you up so you can see the trap set.
That's right. That's right.
Praise God. So you can come back down in the confidence of it. Knowing that God got it. Sometimes you, when you're in the deep of it, it seems like it ain't no way out. Oh, hallelujah, praise God. He said, but he give you rings like an eagle. He will raise you up above it. Praise God. So you can see. Oh, okay, Lord, I thank you. I'm all right now. But listen. This is what he said. He said, "Though an host shall encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. The war shall rise against me. In this will I be what? Confident. I will be confident." Praise God. "Lord, exalt me above my circumstance." Praise God. So you can bring me back down so I can be confident. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. God is good. Praise God. And he will bring peace in the midst of the storm. Praise be the name of the Lord. He bring peace in the midst of the storm. Hallelujah, praise God. I don't know what you're going through. Don't know who it's for. Praise God, but he will give you peace in the midst of the storm. Praise God, but you got to ask him just to rise you above. Praise God, that you can gain your confidence. That you can know that he is ordering your steps. That he's with you. Praise God, it ain't your footsteps in the sand. It's his footsteps in the sand that's carrying you. Blessed be the name of the Lord. God is good. He's simply worthy to be praised. Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Praise God. We remain standing. Praise God. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Praise God. I ask the minister of matters if you will come and share the word, praise God, with us all today. Praise God. Because two of the times he was coming, the Lord shifted direction. Praise God. I tell you, if you in God's house, you got to respect his house.
Well,
when God says shift, then you got to shift. Blessed be the name of the Lord. He's in order. Praise God. When he says shift, praise God, you in order when you in God. Blessed be the name of the Lord. So let's all receive the man of God as he come forth with the word of God. Praise God. Let's all receive him in some matters. Praise God. For holy, amen. Can we give the Lord a praise? Can we give him praise? Can we give him praise? Sometimes it's easier just to give up praise. Sometimes we think too much. We think too much. We just need to give up praise. That's all. Thank you. Hallelujah.
As Bishop was encouraging us with the word of God, I can hear the Lord just speaking to my spirit. The battle is not as big as you think it is. It's actually small. Because greater is in you. So that battle is actually smaller than you think it is. It may seem large to your natural eye, but in the spiritual being, that battle is actually this small. So can we just give the Lord a praise? So we have have the ability and the capability to overcome anything that comes our way. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. No weapon formed against us shall prosper. And every thought, my God, every thought that they even think about coming against you is already condemned. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. So it's actually smaller than you think. Hallelujah. It may look huge. It may look bigger than life, but it's actually smaller than what you made it out to be. Because you've been looking at it with the wrong set of eyes. You've been looking at it through the natural side of you. But if you turn yourself inside out and see through your spirit, you will see how great you are and how small the battle is. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. I just dropped that word in my spirit for somebody in here. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, God, we love you. God, we give you glory. God, we thank you for the greatness that's within us. Father, we thank you for the greatness of your spirit. God, we thank you for power of a sound mind. God, we thank you for peace that passes all understanding. God, we thank you for the joy of the Lord that is our strength. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for peace in the valley. God, we give you glory. We thank you for your word today, Father. Oh, God, we ask you to give us an ear to hear, God. God, give us a heart to receive your word today, God. In the name of Jesus Christ, I'm just a man standing here, God, but with such a great assignment. So, Father, I pray that you'll move me aside, God. In the name of Jesus Christ, God, you be the mouthpiece, God. You speak your word, Father. In the name of Jesus Christ, Lord God, I surrender my hands, my thoughts, God, my eyes, my mouth, my heart. God, I surrender my whole being unto you, God. In this very moment, God, that the assignment that you called me to do today may be accomplished, Father. For you said you would not send your word out void, but God, it will accomplish that you are sending out to do. So, God, accomplish something in this house, Father, with your word today, God. Give us ear to hear, God, and a heart to receive. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. Oh, Lord, my Redeemer, can we all shout amen?
Amen.
Can we all shout amen as you take your seat? God is good. Amen. First giver and all the time. General Overseer, Mother Vincent. Amen. Our bishop. Amen. Our co-pastor, Evangelist Williams. Amen. All the elders, everyone that sits in the kingdom of God today. Amen. And everybody that's in the house, it's himself. Amen. And I asked God to really confirm this message. And he confirmed it. And before Bishop even said the topic, you don't even know he said it, the Lord had already changed the topic from what it was. Just to confirm what it's going to be. And I give God glory because this word has been living in me and it became a part of my life. It became a part of my life. Amen. Because if we don't allow the word to just come in and just reside in us, that's when we start worrying about things and we get frustrated. Amen. And then we just, you know, get down in the dumps and everything else. Because in the word is life. Amen. In the word, there's life. Amen. There's light. There's direction and instruction in the word. So if we allow this life, this light, this direction, this instruction just to reside and live in us, amen, there's no worry. Amen. There's no worry when you got the word. Amen. There's no worry when you got God. Amen. So in the book of 1 Corinthians 2, verses 9 through 12. 2 verses 9 through 12. Amen. But as it is written, I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither have it entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God.
The deep things.
For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so, the things of God knoweth no man, but the Spirit of God. Yeah. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given unto us. Amen. Freely given to us of God. Amen. So, the title of today's message is, You Ain't Seen Nothing Yet. And for the English majors that I just messed up your world, when you ain't seen nothing yet, you haven't seen anything yet. Amen. You know how it is when you really good in English and you type your paper something very well, and if you see somebody's paper or see somebody email and you correcting it as soon as you read it. I have some saints did it in my email. You should have put this. Thank you. So for those of you that's in the house, you haven't seen anything yet. But for those of you that really don't matter, you ain't seen nothing yet. Hallelujah. You ain't seen. Eyes have not seen. Ears have not heard. The things that, and when I read this scripture, and I thank God for Bible study and seeing me and all that, because it taught us how to study the word the right way, glory to God. It taught us how to dig in and get the true meaning of what the scripture is saying. And when I begin to study it, it wasn't actually talking about sometimes we take this scripture, we read it, and we run. You know, it's one of the words when you read it, just run. God, eyes haven't seen. You don't know what God has prepared for me. But what it's saying, it was spoken at a time when it was great crucified Jesus Christ. And it was saying, if they had known what they was doing, they wouldn't have done it. Hallelujah. But because these type things are not revealed in the natural side, it's only revealed in the spiritual side, eyes haven't seen. Ears haven't heard. Meaning your natural eyes haven't seen. Your natural ears haven't heard. It hasn't been felt in your heart. As a matter of fact, you can't even feel the change when it's taking place. Hallelujah. Like I said earlier, you got to turn yourself inside out and see it and hear it and feel it through your spirit. As a matter of fact, you got to know what God is saying in your spirit. Because your flesh will lie to you at all. Your flesh will just lie to you. Amen. Your flesh will just mess you up. If you try to go on what you think and what the natural side you were thinking about, it would just mess you up. But when you begin to put yourself in the spirit of God, and begin to see things how God sees them. Right. You begin to walk around with your head held high.
That's right.
You be like, well, how are you so happy when you got this and this going on? Well, because I got the victory. Well, I don't see it. Well, because you're looking through the wrong set of eyes.
All right.
Come on. What you mean you don't? But you ain't got no job? Yes, I do.
Uh-huh.
What do you mean you ain't got no job? Yes, I do. It just haven't manifested for your eyes to see it, but it's there. Hallelujah. Glory to God. What do you mean the church ain't filled up? Yes, it is. There's only standing room in here. But come on, you don't see these gaps in the pew, though. You're looking through the wrong set of eyes. Glory to God. I have not seen, nor ear heard. Neither have it entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. And I'm going somewhere with this, but I got a question. Do anybody love him in here? Do anybody love the Lord in here? Do anybody love him in here? Glory to God. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Anybody love him in here? Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. So don't worry about it.
My Lord.
Just because you can't see it with your natural eyes doesn't mean it's not happening for you. Amen. So I want to encourage you just to hold on. I'm not going to say a little while longer. I'm just going to say hold on. I'm just going to say hold on, but the enemy going to try to press you out tomorrow. He may try to press you out by Friday, so I'm not going to say hold on a little while longer, but that little while longer may end on Thursday, so I'm just going to say hold on. Take the word and hold on and focus on what God has spoken into your spirit, not what your natural eyes and your natural mind is thinking. Thank you, Jesus. So eyes haven't seen. So you ain't seen nothing yet. You ain't seen nothing yet. And we're going over to the book of Genesis, chapter 37, talk about a young man named Joseph. Because sometimes, as you turn there, sometimes in your life, while you were walking by faith and not by sight, you know, you're doing your devotions and you're singing your songs and you're doing your worship in the morning. Amen. No matter how good or how bad it may sound to the natural ears, you still got your praise and worship going on when you get up in the morning and you still believe in God and doing the best you know how to walk circumspectly. Amen. With your head held high, you're praying and you're coming to Bible study. You're doing all this, but there's always somebody that's in your ear trying to shut you down.
Well,
there's always somebody in your ear that's trying to mess you up. Trying to put doubt there. They don't mean to do it, but they just do it with the words they say. And sometimes you gotta cut it off. Amen. You trying to live positively. You trying to live for the kingdom. You trying to live for God. And they trying to encourage you to live for the enemy. You trying to think the way that God has given you to think, but they trying to shift your thinking to something else. Amen. Your eyes are all, you walking by faith and not by sight, and they say it's not there. You saying yes, it is. So every time you say something, they in disagreement. So, well, I guess the question is that this. How can you walk together if you don't agree? So that means there's a disagreement there, so I can't walk with you no more.
Amen.
You may say, you're going to cut me off just like that, but it's more at stake than you really think. It's more at stake than this. I got to cut you off just like that. I got too much purpose. I got a journey to take, and I don't have time to carry on no extra weight. So yeah, I can cut you, you know, sometimes we talk around it. Yeah, we you know, try your best, you know, just try to cut them off one, you know, don't talk to them every day, maybe twice a week. No, just cut them off. The Lord had already told you, just do it, huh? Don't try to cut them down. It's still gonna be there to trip you up. Hallelujah, cut it off. It's like, you know, I don't do the outside stuff. I'm an office guy. But if you cut down a tree, if you leave a stump, you will still trip over that stump. Amen. The tree may be gone, but you still trying to walk where the tree was, and you tripping over the stump because you got to move the stump.
Amen.
So just move it out of the way completely so you ain't got to trip. You can walk forward straight. Hallelujah. I don't know who that was for in the house, but you just need to cut them off. Don't let them stop you or block you. So we talk about a man, young man named Joseph in Genesis chapter 37. Amen. A very familiar story. Amen. I'm going to read it chapter by chapter, verse by verse. Amen. Glory to God. God is wonderful. Sometimes on this journey we call life. There's, you know, we know we got purpose. I mean, anybody here don't, everybody do. If I show up handy, you know you have purpose. Amen. You know you're called to do something great. Amen. Raise your hand. Come on, raise your hand. Young people, you too, man. You know you got purpose. Amen. I'm going to make sure everybody know. And for those that didn't raise your hand, can I remind you that you have purpose?
Amen.
If you're still in the land of the living, you got something to do. Amen. If you're still down here, that means God has something. He's still calling for you to do something. And there's something still. You still got something to do. And even to my young people that's in here sometimes in school, and I hear this word haters being thrown around a lot.
Yeah.
And we're going to talk about a young man named Joseph. He has some haters too. You know, they use the word haters. And for those that don't know, what are you talking about haters? That ain't, I don't know about no haters. I don't know what haters is. Haters is somebody that's basically jealous of you. So, you know, somebody that just every time you turn around, they talking down to you, they trying to trip you up. So you term them to be a hater. Amen. You term them to be a hater. That's what they do in these days and back in the older days. And so you just jealous of me. So today they said you hating on me. Amen. Either way, don't even worry about it. Keep going forward. Amen. So they're going to be in your life. They're going to exist. So let me just call it to the carpet. Amen. Haters are going to be in your life to try to stop you. That's just how it's designed. Amen. Glory to God. The Adam and Eve had the serpent. Amen. Hallelujah. What makes you think you ain't got nobody else that's going to trip you up? Glory to God. Lord, have mercy. Thank you, Jesus. Everywhere Jesus went, they was hating on him. Glory to God. And he was just trying to fulfill the master's work. So why are you worried about a one? I told you the battle is smaller than what you think it is. You actually giving them more impact on your life than they really have on your life. You focusing an hour of your day on what they said to you or what they said about you instead of taking that hour and focusing on what God is saying to you. Amen. So take that energy, and if we go into Genesis 37, take that energy that you spend focusing on somebody else and what they said about you, what they said to you, what they said on Facebook. Put that energy and pray and do what you got to do.
Amen.
Amen. Genesis 37. And Jacob dwelt in the land wherein his father was a stranger in the land of Canaan. And these are the generations of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, note that he was 17, was feeding a flock with his brethren, and the lad was with his sons of Belial, with the sons of Zilpah, and his father's wives. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. Now Israel loved Joseph more than all of his children. Because he, number one, he was the son of his old age. And he made him a coat of many colors, and when his brethren saw that their father loved him more than all of his brethren, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. Glory to God. So we're talking about Joseph today. He was the youngest of all 12 of his brothers. Amen. He was hated because his father favored him. He was hated because he was the youngest child of his father. Not only that, he was born in his father's old age. Amen. And he was the only child of his two parents. Amen. So he was hated. So he was like a tattletale. You know. Anybody got younger siblings in here? Right? Younger siblings. Younger siblings. Anybody experienced that with your young assembly that everything you did wrong, that, you know, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, and that's how it was. So everything wrong, Joseph was quick to say it. And even when the brothers went to the field, Joseph was home with his father. Because he was favored. Amen. So his father was sent to go and spy on your brothers and tell me what they're doing. He even gave him a special coat. Amen. Anybody got older siblings that seem like your older siblings always getting something and you ain't getting nothing? Amen. Anybody? I got to witness in the back. Amen. So one day, going down to verse 5, Joseph dreamed a dream. You ever dreamed and you knew there was something significant about that dream. Most dreams, you don't remember. But there are some dreams you wake up and you can tell the dream line by line, story by story, word by word. And in that, you believe that God was speaking to you. Anybody ever had that experience?
Amen.
Amen. So Joseph had a dream. He had a dream and he ran and told him about the dream. And he went to his brothers and told them about the dream. And he had another dream and went and told his father about the dream. So let's read about what happened. I'm going to read about it. And Joseph dreamed a dream, and he told it to his brothers, and they hated him yet the more. And he said unto them, "Hear, I pray you, this dream that I have dreamed. For behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheaf rose and also stood upright. And behold, your sheaf stood around about and made obeisance to my sheaf." In other words, basically, we was putting the sheaf together, and mine, yours bowed down to mine, basically. They obeyed mine. And his brother said unto him, "Shalt thou indeed reign over us? Or shalt thou indeed have dominion over us?" And they hated him yet the more for his dreams and for his words. Let me start right there to tell us, especially my young people that are doing something great with your life. Because every young person in here, young adult in here, is doing something great with your lives. Don't allow nobody stop you from chasing your dream. If God has spoke something to your spirit and got you moving forward, you go be that person that God is calling you. You go be that person you're desiring to be. I don't care what they say about you. They can call you nerd. They can call you giggle. They can call you whatever they want to call you.
Amen.
You go forward and do what God is calling you and put it within you to do. Amen. So he dreamed yet another dream and told his brother. And they said, "Behold, I have dreamed another dream. Dreamed a dream more. And behold, the sun and the moon and 11 stars made obeisance to me." And then he told his father and his brother. His father rebuked him and said, "What is this dream that thou hast dreamed? Shall I and thy mother and thy brethren indeed come to bow down ourselves to thee in the earth?" His brethren envied him, but his father observed the same. It's interesting. It's real interesting. He had a dream. And with actually what he had, the Lord would just give him a glimpse of his future. You know, they didn't have nobody that had been preached back then, so the Lord spoke to them in dreams. So the Lord was actually giving him a glimpse of what he was taking them. He didn't give him the whole picture. He just gave him a screenshot of it.
All right.
You know how you take your phone and take a screenshot? He just gave him a screenshot of what he was taking him to.
Go ahead, preacher.
And Joseph was 17 years old, and I'm going to take your mind to another part of it, to look at it a different way. I know we look at this as being Joseph being boastful, but he was 17 years old.
That's right.
And at 17 years old, in that mindset, when you see something like that in your dreams, of course you're going to run and tell somebody.
Yeah.
You know, Naomi woke up one day and had a dream that she had all the money in the world, all the candy in the world. She's going to run and she's going to wake up, she's going to tell her mom and her sisters. He saw something great. And what disturbed me in this scripture, in this passage by his father, his father rebuked him. His father chastised him. But if you know some scripture, his father, while his brothers was envy, his father observed what he was saying. In other words, he put some thought to it. So in his mind, he said, there's got to be something about these dreams. He really should have became like Eli was to Samuel. You know, when Samuel was sleeping in the temple and the Lord was calling him and he didn't know what was going on. And he went to Eli and Eli said, well, the next time he calls, say, he can speak, Lord, your servant is listening.
That's right.
So he really should have been the type that said, you know what, Joe, let's sit down and let's examine this dream.
Yeah.
But you're going to find out later in the scripture that Joseph even told those that he was put to work under that the interpretation of dreams come from God. Uh-huh. And sometimes you need a God to manifest himself to tell you really what he's saying to you.
Amen.
And sometimes you may just need somebody to have the connection to God to really give you the full meaning of what God is saying to you.
Yes.
I'm so glad we got a great connection in the house. Don't you all agree? Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank God for the connection. Amen. To our heavenly purpose. Hallelujah. If I can speak to the mentors in the room. A mentor is somebody, I'm going to be here to help you walk you through your life journey and help you be great and help you to deal with the issues that come up in your life. That's what a mentor does. A mentor is there to help them over the hurdles and the struggles. That's what a mentor does. So at that moment in his life, Joseph really needed somebody to mentor him and really encourage him and say, Joseph, that was a great dream. But Joseph, don't take it the wrong way. It's a God-given purpose behind that dream. Hallelujah. Let's just put him in the pit. And then let's just go tell his father that someone came in and got him and killed him. But we don't want to do it. In other words, I'm not going to kill him, but I'm going to put him in a line to get hurt. See how the enemy works? Ooh, I hear revelation behind there. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going to be the first partaker. Thank you, Lord, for that. You know, the enemy not going to outright just send a missile to your house and take you out. You know, he ain't going to outright, you know, send something to your house and shake your house up and you fall out the bed and you gone. You know, he'll send it to the television, he'll send it to the radio, he'll send it to the person you're dating, you're not supposed to be dating, he'll send it to somebody you're hanging around that you're not supposed to be hanging around. You know, and they'll pick at you. They just pick at you. They ain't gonna try to, you know, they ain't gonna pounce you and take you out right like that. He's just gonna pick at you. And pick at you till he gets you so weak where he can just blow and you fall there. You remember the story of the three pigs? They're just gonna pick at you. The enemy just gonna pick at you. But he know you ain't been studying your word. He know you ain't been praying, Corona. You ain't been praying like you're supposed to. Your devotions went from 20 minutes or 30 minutes down to 10 minutes because you're rushing out the door and you saying, Lord, keep me today. So the enemy is going to pick at you. So he know, oh, he ain't really praying today. He ain't really connected to God today. So I can just pick at him at work. I can just send an employee into his office to make him really mad. And he's going to say something that's out of the character of God. So I'm just going to pick at him, take him out piece by piece. So the enemy will set you up and put you in the line of fire. And so Reuben's plan was, well, okay, when I tell them to do that, I'm the oldest brother. They got to listen to me. So they're going to do it. When you know how them big sisters and big brothers be, you know. So he said, well, what I'll do is when they leave, I'll come back and get them and take them home. So he had all planned out in his head. And how many know our natural plan is not really the plan of God?
Amen.
How we conjure up something in our mind is it's not really the God ain't going to. If you naturally conjure up a plan in your mind that you can actually do without God's help, that's not really God's plan. Because the plan of God, only God has to be a part of it. He orchestrates it.
That's right.
So you, with your natural thinking, cannot do it. You need God. You need the great and mighty, all-powerful God to really orchestrate the plan that he has for your life. And so when he went back and saw that Joseph was gone, because his brothers had sold him into slavery, he began to get scared. And he went weeping and crying, and they told his father. And this brings us to my next point. We already know that Joseph was favored. And we already know that Joseph saw a glimpse of where he was going, but still he hadn't seen anything yet. But when he got to Egypt, to Potiphar's house, you ever found your place, you know, the Lord didn't give you a plan, he didn't give you, He done gave you a glimpse of where you're going. He done gave you a word. The bishop that called you out and the Lord that gave him to give you a word. And you trying to hold on to that word, but it seemed like it's going the opposite direction of that word. Anybody ever been there? It seemed like your life is, you know, you got the word, you know it was God. And God confirmed it 2, 3, 4, 5 times. You know it was God. But it seemed like everything is going against the word that God and the promises that God has spoken to you. And you feel a little discouraged, and the enemy's trying to take you down, but let me encourage you that you're just in the process of it.
All right.
Don't abort yourself in the process. Don't give up while you're in the process of becoming great. Hallelujah. So Joseph found himself at Potiphar's house. And we're going to move on to the next chapter, 39. 39. And I'm about done. A couple more points, I'm there. So we know he was favored. They tried to take him out, but you can't kill the purpose of God.
Amen.
You can't do it. You just can't. Well, God has put something in position, in place. You can speak against it all you want to, but you will get hurt trying to do that versus somebody else getting hurt. Versus you trying to hurt the plan and purpose of God. You're really hurting yourself.
Come on now.
You're really hurting yourself when you speak against the things and the plans of God. You're really taking yourself out. Amen. You're really weakening your own self. It's like taking communion when you know you've been sinning and doing wrong. The Bible said that they would become sleepy and sickly among you. So when you begin to speak against the things and the plans and the purpose of God, you become weak and you become sickly.
Huh, Reverend?
Because you just spoke against the ordinance of God. And you may say, I didn't tell God that, but when it came, when the order came through his man or his woman servant, whoever that person was at that time, through our bishop, our co-pastor, when the order came, he spoke against it, thought against it. It didn't grab the thought and repent and cast it down real quick. But we pondered on it and we thought about it and we spoke against it. Let me tell you, some people of God, you're really hurting yourself. We're hurting ourselves when we do that. We are hurting ourselves when we do that, because we're speaking death to ourselves and to our situations versus speaking life. Amen. We speak against the things of God. Amen. This is a quick footnote that the Lord just dropped in my spirit. Amen. So let's go to Joseph. Amen. Go back to Joseph, Genesis 39. So he was sold out by his brothers, but yeah, it was set up by God. Amen. His brothers didn't even know. You just operating in my plan, don't you? That's why Reuben's plan wasn't working, because that's not how the way that God wanted it. How else was Joseph going to end up where he was to help feed them and give the king the interpretation of his dream? How else was all this going to happen? He had to end up there somehow. And surely he wasn't of that type statue just to walk up there. He couldn't do that. So how else was he going to be in there but to be sold in as a slave? Hallelujah. Well, sometimes we don't understand the plan of God because we really can't see with a natural eye, but if we really keep focusing on God, we will understand and know that God is really setting us up to be great. Amen. He's really working some things, but it's like a step by step by step by step process. Don't give up at step 2, because step 10 is right here. Hallelujah. You just keep reaching and keep stepping up. Glory to God. And the steps may seem a little high. It may seem a little hard. It may seem a little more difficult to climb, but I declare if you keep climbing and keep pushing, you're going to reach what you supposed to be in God. Don't give up in the process, saints. So you ain't seen nothing yet. Don't give up in the process. Don't give up. Woo. Glory to God. Trying to keep myself together up here. Don't give up in the process. Yeah, I know them. Sometimes them pains, they rock through your body and never before, but if he healed you before, if he done it before, I declare he'll do it again. If he done it the last time, he's no respect a person. He will do it again. If he did it for the mother over there, he will do it for the sister over here. If he kept the brother over here, he will keep the brother over here. So if he done it before, I declare he will do it again. People are going, hold on. Look at somebody and say, hold on. Look at somebody else and say, hold on. Don't you dare give up in the process. Don't you dare abort yourself in the process. Get your head off. an escape key. Hallelujah. It's not time to give up. You got somewhere to go. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, God. You thought the business was great then, Brother Darrell, but just wait. You ain't seen nothing yet. Reach. Glory to God. You ain't seen nothing yet. Just wait. It's connected to a real purpose. To God. It's a greater purpose. We looking at the things that's going on around us and we getting all concerned and all worried and all weighed out, getting all sick, can't get out of bed, we can't sleep at night, we staying up all times of night. I declare you don't need to worry about it. It's a greater purpose behind it. You're in a development stage of your life.
Yes, sir.
He's trying to develop you. How else are you going to get to where God would have you to be? How else would you go through to get there? If I could go to my job for just 1 second. Sometimes we just implementing a new system at work, and when you're trying to implement this system, we run through all these scenarios to test it out, to make sure the system can handle it, make sure the program will work right. And this and that, we testing it out, and while we testing it out, we're developing processing, we're developing procedures for it. And sometimes while you're going through, God is saying, I'm just testing you out so I can develop you. Because as you growing up, you're getting procedures and you're getting plans on how it's going to be done. So when somebody else come up behind you, they will know how to do it. Because one day I won't be here to do this, but somebody else got to know how to do it. So yes, you want to develop the stage. Just write it down. Just write it down. Because somebody going to need the manuscript of your life. Hallelujah. To get them to the next level that you just got to. Hallelujah. Sister Mary, somebody going to need the manuscript of what you went through in your body. So just write it down. Write down your remedy that God giving you to what to do. Hallelujah. Because somebody will come along and need that same encouragement.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Well, how do you remain so strong? And how do you remain so happy and you keep worshiping, singing like that? Well, here's my process. Well, here's how it happened. This is how God gave it to me, and this is how he's doing it.
Uh-huh.
Glory to God. This is where the scriptures came from. It was written as they lived it. Thank you, Jesus. So Joseph was sold into slavery. Genesis 39. Y'all, I'm not going to read all of it. I'm just going to jump around. Mm-hmm. But declare somebody, don't give up. I know it's easier to say, don't give up in here. And then you go to your Monday experience. And give up is knocking at your door. Just tell them ain't nobody home. You're not allowed here. Ain't nobody home. Let me get the authorities on the line. Doc, you can't come in today. Let me get the authorities on the line. I have somebody at my house that's not supposed to be here. He's trying to get in, but I'm not letting him in. Could you send the cops around him? Get him off what? Get him off my porch.
Hallelujah.
Oh, yeah. You better say, well, who is the authority over our Father, which art in heaven?
Yeah.
Hallowed is his name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Sometimes you got to get the authorities on the line. Hallelujah. Well, doubt is trying to get in here.
Yeah.
Glory to God. Confusion is knocking at my door. Hallelujah. Disobedience is ringing my doorbell. I ain't not answering this time.
Amen.
I know what you all about.
Amen.
Get away. Glory to God. Matter of fact, put the authorities on speed dial. You know, you don't have to unlock your phone to dial 911. Hallelujah. Glory to God. You don't have to go into a real long praise and worship session to make a 911 call. Just say, Jesus, help me. Glory to God. There's somebody at my door that don't belong there. There's somebody trying to get in my life that don't belong here. There's somebody trying to get in my mind that don't belong here. God, I got to get the power out of here. It can't live here. It can't dwell here. I got somewhere to go. Take authority. Glory to God. Don't let the enemy run you out your own house, your own privilege. You deserve who you're going. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Don't let him do it. Don't let him do it. You've been letting him do it for too long. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I hear the Spirit of God say, it's time for you to stand up. I'm already standing up in you. Now, if you stand up and agree with me, hallelujah, we can do some things. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Oh, you're not going to win today. You're not going to win ever. I got the victory. I got authority. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. No, there's no condemnation. No, I'm more than a conqueror. I heard a song say, you're not just a conqueror, but you're more than a conqueror. I'm more than a conqueror in this situation right here. So get off my front door post. Don't go to the back door. You can't get in back then either. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm covered. Every door is locked. You can't get in. I've been sealed by redemption's story, Jesus Christ. Oh, yeah, yeah, the blood works. The blood works. It sealed me. It covered me. You can't get in. Stop trying to get into my eyes. You can't do it. You can't do it. I'll just turn you off. Hallelujah. My ears can't hear you right now. I'm too focused on the plan and purpose of God to take you seriously right now. Are you seriously trying to come at me and speak doubt? Do you know who I am? Glory to God. Sometimes you just got to say it out loud. Devil, do you know who I am? Do you know who my father is? He favors me. He watches over me. Glory to God. He got purpose all in me. I'm greater than that situation. Who do you think you are? Who do you think you are? Who do you think you are? Hallelujah. Glory to God. I'm backed up by the power of God. I'm backed up by, I'm armed with Jesus Christ. Who do you think you are? Glory to God. I don't apologize because the Spirit of the Lord says somebody just need to go home and take authority. You've been going home and enemy been kicking you around and been pushing you around, and it's time for you to go home and say, "You, I've had enough." Just walk in your house, leave the door because somebody getting out. Yeah. You know, we come to church to get a fix, you know. You know how they do when they get the charges at the hospital when somebody's out there. Clear. And that's what happens. We come to church. We tell them about clear and we do this. And then we go back Monday and Friday. We wrestle with the same devil. We come back on Sunday. Clear. And that ain't gonna work no more. God said it's time for permanent fix. It's time for permanent fix. Glory to God. You need to speak to their mind. Hallelujah. You must say, well, I need to scripture what David encouraged himself. Why can't you? Glory to God. And the word is life. Speak the word to yourself. Speak the word to your mind. Speak the word to your thoughts. Speak the word. Speak the word. Speak the word. Your mouth filthy, speak the word. The word will clean it up. Hallelujah. Speak the word. Your heart broken, speak the word to your heart. Glory to God. Tell your heart you got to come back together. I got too much work to do. I ain't got time to be wrestling out with a broken heart. So God, I need you to mend this thing so I can go forth to your purpose. Let the door here and speak the word. Let this mind be in you which is also in Christ Jesus. For the peace of God that passes all understanding to take over the thoughts of your mind. Speak the word. There's power in the word. There's power in the word. There's authority in the word. All we got to do is speak the word. Get the word in your ear. Get the word in your heart. Get the word in your mind. I declare every battle that you face, when you get the word, you'll be defeated. The word. The word. The authority's in the word. The authority's in the word. Your natural thinking can't do it. Your natural eyes can't see it. Your natural ears can't even perceive it. Your natural tongue can't even speak it right. But when you go down in your spirit, begin to speak the word of God. Everything that's not right, everything that's crooked, gotta straighten up and get it right. Glory to God. Take a door. Take a door. Take a door. So that transient direction was the Holy Spirit. So to really sum up Joseph real quick, he got into Potiphar's house and Potiphar said the Lord must be with him. He got to be with him. Because everything he touches prospers, everything he touches successful. God got to be with him. everything he think is happening, God got to be with him. The Lord has got to be with him in order for you to get where God would have you to be. The Lord has to be with you. So as a matter of fact, if you look at the time frame, when Joseph got there, he wasn't no longer 17. He grew up. See, we look at the journeys in the Bible as if they got in their car, ran there, and drove down the street, and they were there in 10 minutes. No, it was a journey. It was a journey. As a matter of fact, he was sold twice. So when he, by the time he got to Egypt, he was ready. Glory to God, the Lord was with him. So somewhere on his journey, he found God. So somewhere on your journey of life, you got to find God. Glory to God. You got to get him. You don't leave home without him. Don't leave home without him. Don't go home without him. Don't go to sleep without him. Glory to God. You can't even wake up without him. Hallelujah. So Joseph had the Lord, and when he got to Potiphar's house, and Potiphar said, well, I'm going to make him my assistant, and he was his assistant, and his wife tried to get, Potiphar's wife tried to get him, and Joseph said, no, I can't do that sin against God. I was like, wow, that's the first time I've heard Joseph speak like that. In order for him to know that it was a sin against God, he had to know who God was. Yes. So when the scripture said the Lord was with him, it was telling the truth. So, yeah. And so he began to run. Sometimes you just got to roll out. I told you, man, entertaining that joke for too long, it's time for you to roll out. Hallelujah. Glory to God. You been walking and dancing around it for too long. Just cut it off. Hallelujah. It keep coming up. That's for somebody in the house for real. You just need to cut it off. That relationship, I don't know who it is, but you've been dealing and wrestling with something. You've been trying to minimize it, and you've been trying to put it in the corner. God said, just cut it off. just cut it off. It means you no good. Cut it off. It's evil for you. Cut it off. There is just a weight attached to it. There is attached itself to your life, and you need to cut it off if you ever want to be free. Glory to God, son. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. I can't stop walking from you. Lord, help me with this. I hear you, God. Cut it off. Cut it off. Cut it off. Just say, in the name of Jesus. They won't stop texting you. Just tell them to talk in the name of Jesus. Glory to God. Just cut it off. They won't stop calling you. Pick up the phone. In the name of Jesus. Hang it up. Cut it off. Glory to God. You just got to cut it off. Who is that word for in the house? Stop rushing the book and cut it off. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. All the way back to Joseph, So he ended up in the jail. And the wife lied and said, he tried to get me. And he tried to touch me. He tried to rape me. And so they put him in the king's prison. Not just a regular prison, but king's prison. Did you see God's plan being manifested right here? Because the Lord showed him was about to take place, but in order for it to take place, he got to be in position. So God was using all this to get him in position. So he was in the king's prison, and even in the king's prison, the Lord was with him. So that lets me know that once we get God, hallelujah, wherever we go, God is with us. Wherever we go, God is with me. So I don't have to be afraid of the terror by night or the arrow that flies by day. He's with me. He talks with me. He walks with me. He tells me that I am his own. He's with me. Nicole, he's with you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. He's with me when I'm on a bus. He's with me on a train. He's with me in my car. Glory to God. God is just with me. I can't help it. I'm favored. I can't help that I'm anointed. I can't help it. He did. I didn't call myself. He called me. I just answered the door. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. So if you spend your time not focusing on what somebody else doing or what they not doing and answer your call, you won't have time to worry about nobody else. Hallelujah. So the same God that's with me is with you also. The same one that called me also called you. Uh-huh. Glory to God. So if we get busy about kingdom business, glory to God, we ain't got time to cause business in the kingdom. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So back to Joseph. So he was in the prison, the king's prison. And glory to God. And thank you, Jesus. So he was in the prison. And even in the prison, God said, the Lord must be with him. And I noticed something in the scripture. Joseph never said that. Come, Pastor, he didn't say it. He just lived it. He didn't say it. He just lived it. So the question is, when you go to work or young people, when you at school, do they know that the Lord is with you? How do you carry yourself? What's your conversation like? You got to look at all that. Do they know that God is with me? Because if they know that they don't know that God is with me, how are they going to get the gospel of Jesus Christ? Except they know that the Lord is with you. Hallelujah. So the king, the head of the prison said, I'm going to put you right up under me. I mean, ain't nothing going to happen in a prison except they go through you.
Right.
How do you be even in charge in jail? All y'all locked up and confined, but you in charge. The Lord had to be with him.
Amen.
And so then they brought in a baker and a cupbearer, the other one. I can't think of what he is right now. But they brought in two people. And they brought him in. And they said, and Joseph walked in and said, I'm gonna put them two under you. And I was reading this, I'm telling you, the word is awesome. I was reading, I said, I could just, when you read the end and then go back and read how I got to the end, it's a mighty powerful word. It's powerful. So I was seeing how God was orchestrating everything, because they had the dreams that got to the way he was. And they ended up under his rule in the prison. They could have been anywhere in the king's prison, but they was under Joseph. And so they had a dream. And while they had a dream, they were looking sad, and Joseph said, what's wrong? I said, well, we had a dream, and And we don't understand what it means. And Joseph began to interpret the dreams and tell us that, well, you're going to be put back in position, but you, they're going to take out. To paraphrase it, we can read back at the exact word, basically. So what happened was, but he said, when you get back into your position to be able to give the king his cup again, don't forget about me. Don't forget you, saints of God, you will never be forgotten about. Don't forget about me.
All right.
A place in God's kingdom for everybody. Don't forget about me. So all that went down and it happened as Joseph gave the interpretation, that's how it happened. Basically, and the thing that I found so awesome, Joseph said, well, don't all the interpretation of dreams come from God? Don't all mysteries of the gospel, everything you just ever don't understand, just go to God. God, I don't understand, but go to God and ask him about it. He will know it. And when the time is right, he will give you the interpretation of what you're going through. Hallelujah, but you got to have an open ear and open heart to receive it. Because it may just come on a Sunday morning or a Wednesday night. You just never know. But you just got to be in the right place at the right time to hear what God is saying to you. Ooh, God is worthy. So when Joseph got there and when they got back in position, he gave the king his cup and the king had a drink. I'm going through this to tell you that God's plan. You ain't seen nothing yet. Just stay where you at. So he got back, when he got it back, and he gave the king his cup. He said, oh, king, and he repented, felt bad because he forgot. He said, there is an interpreter in the king's prison, in your prison, that can interpret the dreams that you had. So the king got him in, and Joseph interpreted it, and before you knew it, Joseph was in position to where he's supposed to be. Because he got there, and he told the dream what was about to happen. The 7 years of famine and the 7 years of harvest of reaping. And he spoke the word to him. And he told him what the dream meant. And the king was so great, he brought him up. He said, you're going to rule beside me. Glory to God. So don't wonder about where you're at and how you're going to get to where God has showed you a long time ago. Just hold on, be patient and trust him. And stay right there. Don't you move. Just be still and grow in God. Because as you keep focusing on him and what he's called you to do and your purpose in him, you're going to find yourself before you know it, you're going to be ruler beside where you're supposed to be. So hold on. Look at somebody and say, hold on. It's almost time. So it happened as Joseph said it was going to happen. Glory to God. And the blessing part about it, he had to interact with his brothers again. The one that hated on him in the beginning. So can I say this to college students that's in the house? I know in a high school senior that's on the way to greatness, glory to God, you're going to have somebody there while you pushing your way through and becoming successful. They're not doing so great because they're going to try to hold you back. But the same ones that's trying to hold you back and trying to hold you down, those are the very ones that will come to you for help later on. So you just stay still and just stay focused on the purpose of God, the plan of God, because God will need you in the right mindset to be able to minister Jesus Christ to them and help them get out of the pit that they found themselves in. Hallelujah. So what happened was they had the famine and they had the harvest and they had the famine as Joseph had interpreted, which was given by God. And everywhere he went, he said those interpretations come from God. He told the king, if the Lord shall give it to me, I shall give it to you. And he gave the interpretation and it happened thus and so. And a part of that famine was his brothers and his father. And he sent for them. And if you read the story, you would realize that they went through a whole long conversation. Matter of fact, they went back and forth. It was a back and forth thing. And Joseph finally revealed himself. And they was repenting and everything else. He said, don't you know that God, the Lord, preserved me so I can be in position to help you? And that's where I'm going to close at. The Lord is preserving us to be in position to help somebody else. And if you notice that Joseph was successful, he was successful everywhere he went. So don't think that God is just on purpose, you just to help somebody else and you're going to be down in the dumps. No, brothers and sisters. The Lord will take care of us because we're doing his purpose and fulfilling his work. So when we get all indulged and completely covered in God's plan and purpose and begin to go forth and do what God is calling us to do, I declare you ain't seen nothing yet. Because not only are you going to be great and successful, but that brother, that sister that's looking up to you, that child that everybody looking at saying, ain't nothing going to happen, ain't nothing good going to come out of that. I'm sorry, I say ain't that again, didn't I? So, That child that everybody looking at said, oh, ain't nothing good gonna come out of there. No. Just look at him and said, don't believe me, just watch. What's the song that people don't believe me? Just watch. Just watch. Keep looking. Keep looking. I declare, if you keep looking, you're gonna see the testimony. Glory to God. It's gonna be. It may be. You know. It may not happen tomorrow, but it's going to happen. Don't believe me. Just watch. We can all stand to our feet. Amen. So just keep that in mind, young people. Amen. Saints of God. Let's be encouraged. Amen. Because what we're going through now is gonna pay off later. Hallelujah. Where you at now is not gonna be. It's not gonna be where you always will be. Glory to God. The greatness that He showed to you early on when you first got saved, or last year, or 10 years ago, it's going to come to pass. You ain't seen nothing yet. Can we give God praise in the house? Come on, can we praise Him for real? Can we not defy Him for real? Come on, somebody. Praise Him for real. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people. Called out of darkness into His marvelous life. To pull somebody else in the light. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Believe the Lord is done. I thank God for the word. I don't know about you, but I thank God for the word. I thank God for the word. I thank God for the word. And my son is going to thank you for the life that I took. Thank God for this word. It helped me get disciplined. It helped me to start that discipline journey that Bishop is talking about. I'm not saying it because Bishop is in the room. I'm saying it because of that. Glory to God. So there may be more. And we know how this time of service goes. But I want you to come up here different this time. I don't want you to come with your head down. Because God has a purpose for you. He has a plan for you. His purpose for you to go through this. But you cannot go through and become successful without Him. So if you don't have Jesus Christ, if you don't know Him in the pardon of your sins, if you're not saved today, please come meet me at the altar. Please come meet me at the altar. Don't leave here without Jesus. Don't leave here without Him in your heart. If you have messed up and you got saved, but you messed up and you're trying to get back right and you're trying to get back on that right road to go the right way, come on down to the altar and let God do it. If you got distracted on your journey and you need God's help, come on down to the altar. The altar is open for anybody in the house that need prayer or want to pray or want to talk to God about some things in your life. I wish that I could tell you just what I want, and you give it to me just like that. The truth of the matter, what I want just might hurt me. And you won't let me go out like that. See, you know my end before my beginning. You calculated blessings right on down to the penny. So I'll grind till you tell me. Let it go and let it be. Oh Lord, your will is what's best for me. Anybody want God's will done today? No rubies and no diamonds. benefits you promised my